Narada Bhakti Sutras, the very opening Bhakti Sutra by Narada Muni is Sātvasmin Paramaprema Rupa Amrutasvarupa Cha Yam Ladva Puman Tripto Bhavati Siddho Bhavati Amruto Bhavati. That is how he begins, Narada, saying that bhakti is such, attaining which a person becomes tripta, completely satisfied. Siddha has found fulfillment. Amrito bhavati, becomes immortal. That is the power of bhakti. Yam yat prapya, having attained which, navanchati, does not desire for anything, nashochati, does not have any sorrow, which is janma marana sorrow, and all sorrows associated with the world are not there for such a person. Such a person, nadveshti, doesn't hate anybody, does not have any ill feeling for anybody. Naramati, does not even enjoy the worldly pleasures, he is not entangled in the worldly pleasures. So beautifully, Narada starts the Bhakti Sutra saying, if you attain this bhakti, then all this is possible for you. And he continues to say, yagyatva, one who knows this, what happens to him? He becomes matto bhavati, gets intoxicated, does not have any sense of what is happening. He becomes atma ramo bhavati. Atma ramo means he becomes established in his own self. Therefore, bhakti is what we want to talk about. And these bhakti sutras are by the Parama Bhakta. Narada is considered as one of the greatest bhaktas of Vishnu. And bhakti derives its root from the word bhaja. Bhaja means to devotedly remember someone, to devotedly think of someone, to love someone devotedly. Bhaja, bhajana. And therefore, in our scriptures, though there are many kind of philosophies are there, as they say, as many people, that many paths. But bhakti has been given one of the most important place in the Indian idea of service to God or spirituality. And you know, Navavidha Bhakti, again Bhagavatam comes in and it says there's various kinds of bhakti in which we can remember or devote ourselves to God. Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu Smaranam, Archanam, Vandanam, Padasevanam, Dasyam, Sakhyam, Atmanivedanam. So it describes 9 kinds of bhakti, starting with Shravanam. Why bhajana is important? Because somebody listens to the name of God may attain bhakti by listening to the name of God. Kirtanam, by singing the name of God. Sankirtana, singing Sankirtana karo. Vishnu Smaranam, by remembering God all the time. Archanam, you worship God in various ways. Vandanam, you pray to God in all situations. Padasevanam, you serve God's feet. Where is his feet? Sarvatapani padam. His feet are everywhere. His hands are everywhere. So in everyone you serve God. Dasyam, in such a way that you ultimately become a servant of God in all times. Even if you are the ruler of a kingdom, you are still a servant of God. That is dasyam. Sakhyam, you become, develop so much of kinship with God that you become dear and dear to God, near and near to God, like God's friend, God's very own. And finally, Atmanivedanam. The closer and closer you got to God, you become like God. Because of the closeness to God. Continuously thinking of God, like Bharata became like Rama. Could not differentiate between Rama and Bharata because they both looked alike. Uddhava became like Krishna. So that is the idea of Atmanivedanam. Ultimately, you become one with the Lord. You don't differentiate. So bhakti is capable of starting from just listening to the name of God and taking you all the way to becoming God. That is the power of bhakti. But yam labdva is not available to everybody. To the one by whom it gets attained, the one who gets it, he alone becomes like this. Tripto, matto, atmarabho, amruto, siddho, everything he becomes. Gets free from all sorrows, all desires, all kinds of dualities, and has no enthusiasm. Notsahi, they say, though does not have any enthusiasm for the world anymore, because his mind is always attached to the thought of God. That is how bhakti came into picture. Before we start the Bhagavad Gita Parayanam, I want to give the background of bhakti. Very Upanishads don't carry this much of bhakti tradition because they are generally Vedantic. And Vedantic, you straight away claim that you and God are one. There is Advaita Vedanta. But do Advaita Vedantis alone saying that way? Many people also have said that Advaita Vedantis also say that bhakti is important. Shankaracharya, on one side, he composed all kinds of suktams, all kinds of stotrams on all gods almost. At the same time, he also described the highest of the wisdom, which is, so how is it this apparently two things exist in the same person? So like the two sides of a seed. See, bhakti, jnana exist simultaneously. Bhakti on one side and jnana on the other side are not different from each other. The one who has bhakti will attain jnana. The one who has jnana will naturally develop bhakti. So both will come together. So it so happened that at some point in time in our culture and history, this bhakti tradition, though it was been talked even from Bhagavatam times, or you see Rama's times, or you go back even before that, rishis were there. Bhaktis were of different kind. Guru bhakti, Matru bhakti, Pitru bhakti, everything is bhakti. Devotedly remember and serve someone, you become a bhakta. The true bhakti is parabhakti. This parabhakti is first mentioned in Shvetashtvara Upanishad. That is where the first mention of word bhakti comes in Upanishads. But it talks about Daiva Bhakti, Guru Bhakti. It does not talk about completely the Parabhakti side. But Parabhakti is the ultimate bhakti. What is Parabhakti? You're not just devoted to your wife. That is wife bhakti. That is husband bhakti. Guru bhakti. But this is the bhakti to the ultimate para, beyond, to the divine self. So that is the idea of bhakti. Now, it so happened that at some point in time, these pandits and brahmanas, they took over the whole society. They became the counselors and advisors of the kings, and they ignored the lower classes, so to say. Though Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Chaturvarna Maya Srishtam, I only have created all the four, Brahmana, Vaishya, Shudra, Kshatriya, all are created by. Purusha Suktam says, Brahmanasya Mukhamasi, Bahu Rajanya Krita, Uru Tadasya Dveshva, Prado Shudra Jayat, so Padbhyagam. From the feet came the Shudras. It all mentions, yet the Brahmanas at some point in time, like today's political bhakti, they created another sect of bhakti, a bhukti sect of bhakti, that is. So they wanted to control everything, and they made sure that Shudras cannot enter temple, women cannot participate in such rituals, and this all has to be done under their complete permission and under their authority. So because of that, the tradition of Indian spirituality started declining. That is when Buddha came, and he proposed that there is no caste system. So everybody liked Buddhism. Jain, Mahavira came around the same time. This is before 500 BC. That time they came and started promoting this, and everybody liked this idea. Those who were suffering under this Brahmanic kind of dominance, and Kshatriyas were nothing but playing second fiddle to the Brahmins because they wanted to be the good books. So the lower caste, the Vaishyas, Shudras were ignored, especially the Shudras. So they started subscribing to the idea of Buddhism, Jainism, and many kings also took, when they realized that's where the vote bank is, Dalit vote bank. So all the kings shifted, those who wanted to. Ashoka shifted like this, many others. Chandragupta shifted like this. They started developing their own and promoting this also, because to conquer more kingdoms, they wanted to promote a single ideology which will appease everybody, and that's how they can rule the kingdom. So at that point of Indian culture and spirituality suffered very badly at the hands of these kind of very narrow ideologies. And that is the time when from the south this bhakti movement restarted. It was always there, but it had somehow gone down. So restarted from this Nayanas, Alvars, or the Shiva Bhaktas, or they were Vishnu Bhaktas. They were composed, they were simple poets, they wrote small poems. And they said that there is no, not necessary to offer flowers, offer water, offer all kinds of things. You can worship God even without that, by simple, pure-hearted devotion to God, wherever you are. That idea met with severe criticism from the higher classes, because they are losing control over things. And that is how what started from the south went up through Karnataka. You know, Basavanna is there, Kamahadevi is there, Allama Prabhu is there. From there, Madhvacharya, then you have that. They also came with different paths of bhakti. Madhvacharya, Advaita Bhakti, Ramanujacharya, Vishishta Advaita. Shankaracharya came with the Advaita Bhakti, Vedanta Bhakti. And then it went to Meera and Kabir and Surdas, Ramadas. It went on like this, spread to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And all around the country, India got united because of bhakti movement. It did not get united because of kings. It did not get united because of Hinduism. It got united because of bhakti movement. Tulsidas, Suradas, Kabirdas in the north, on the Vitala, Namadeva, Ekanath, Tukaram on the west, on the east, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and the likes, in the south, Allama Prabhu and Alwars, Nayanars. So they all revived this tradition of bhakti. Of course, after that, Shaivites fought with Vaishnavites. That's a different story. That's much only they understood the bhakti. They could not go to the para bhakti. They got stuck at the apara bhakti level. That's why they thought Vishnu is greater than Shiva, Shiva is greater than somebody else is greater than somebody else. And again, it got into the similar confusion. Till further down, Vivekananda rose again. And he again got this idea of bhakti and advaita together. And he started preaching that, yes, he showed guru bhakti first to his own guru. And Ramakrishna Paramahamsa himself tried everything, all paths he has tried, including all religious paths he has tried. At the end, he finally found refuge only in bhakti. He went trying jnana yoga, he tried dhyana yoga, he tried sannyasa yoga, he tried all kinds of yoga dhyana, and also he tried various other kinds of these, what we call the left side of spirituality, not the left wings, the left side, that is all this tantra, mantra, everything he tried. He lived like a Christian, lived like a Muslim. At the end of it, he came to conclusion that the only place he found real peace is when he was worshipping the mother as a child. And that Vatsalya Bhakti he developed for, and that is how he started developing more and more peace and bliss. Ultimately, he also realized, by none of these other methods he realized. Almost 12 years he spent doing all kinds of things, but he did not realize the Brahman, the oneness. It is only in bhakti to the mother Kali, when he came and said, "You give, show me yourself, otherwise I will cut my head with the same sword that you are holding in your hand." That is when she manifested and told, "Don't do that." And that's how he attained the Bhava Samadhi, and after that it became a regular thing. So he attained all these through bhakti. Of course, all the other paths helped him to purify himself. All the other paths. But ultimately, his attainment came only through bhakti. So why in Bhagavad Gita, there are so many yogas are there in Bhagavad Gita. But we have picked up bhakti as the first and the foremost. Because if you understand bhakti, yam labdva, if you get that bhakti, amruto bhakti, atma ramo bhakti, you are done, you are finished with your syllabus. Don't have to read the rest of the chapters. Rest are only descriptions. If you can get this bhakti. But to get this bhakti, it's not as straight as it sounds. You have to purify, you have to go through tremendous austerities, tremendous dedication, one-pointedness, ananya bhakti. All this is part of the bhakti. You cannot say, "I'm jnani and I'm not a bhakta." Bhakti jnana, both come together. But there is a process with which one understands. Purification is the process, chitta shuddhi. So that is the idea of why bhakti is most important in today's time. And obviously, bhakti has to be pointed towards someone. In bhakti, there has to be a bhagavan and there has to be a bhakta. And the bond between them is bhakti. Like a mother is there and a child is there, the bond between them is vatsalyam. A friend is there, another friend is there, between them is maitri. A husband is there, wife is there, between them is raga. Likewise, there has to be a God, a person, a personification of the divinity, and there has to be an individual. Without the two, bhakti cannot happen. So that is where bhakti yoga comes into picture. and it explains how does one attain parabhakti and what is the qualities of a bhakta. So you may say, I am a bhakta. Many people say, I am Swami's devotee. But that is not given to you to claim that. That is given to me to proclaim, whether you are a devotee or not. Whether I am Swami's devotee, it is not given to you. It is given to me to tell that. You can only say, I am trying to devote myself to Swami. I am trying to be a good devotee of Swami. But what is a good devotee? The whole of 12th chapter is describing that. What is a good devotee? Even one quality of that good devotee with the 12th chapter describes is so hard to practice at all times. Sarvatra. Simple. Sarvatra samabuddhaya. Always equanimous. One word it is of Bhagavad Gita. That is what he said. It's more than one whole state of Massachusetts. One word of Bhagavad Gita. One line of Bhagavad Gita. So one word, samabuddhaya. Take that word. Anapeksha. Take that word. Udasina. Nirmama. Irahankara. Shami. Take one word. That's a whole life sadhana. In fact, lifetime sadhana that is. To just get to follow one word of Bhakti Yoga. One pada. Whoever gives, even God comes to give an Upadesha on the whole Bhakti Yoga, nothing will go inside unless you decide to learn. That is why you please pay attention, serious attention, and try to imbibe what it is saying. And it is so beautifully it defines Bhakti and all the aspects of a Bhakta and how one should attain.
अथ द्वादशोऽध्यायः अर्जुन उवाच एवं सततयुक्ताय एवं सततयुक्ताय भक्ता स्वां पर्युपासते भक्ता स्वां पर्युपासते ये चाप्यक्षरमव्यक्तम् ये चाप्यक्षरमव्यक्तम् तेषां के योगवित्तमाः
Bhakti Yoga starts with this question of Arjuna. Who is better between one who is devoted to the form of God and one who worships, adores, contemplates on, meditates on your original nature as attributeless one and formless one? That is between Sakara and Niraka. Simple question is, who is better between one who is devoted to Sakara, one with form, another Nirakara without form? See, that is the question which is asked by Arjuna.
Evam, this way, Satata Yukta, continuously engaged in, which way? The way in the previous chapter is said, by completely devoting oneself to God. Bhaktas, Paryupasate, those who worship you in that way, versus, next line, yes. Yecha api, those who otherwise, how do they worship? Aksharam avyaktam, the one without a form, without a attribute, who cannot be described, they worship him. In between the tesham, between the two, ke yoga vittamah, who is the better of the yoga, yogi, or the one who is in the path of this yoga, according to you, is the Krishna asking. That is the Sakara Nirakara debate.
Shri Bhagavan Vacha Maya Vishya Mano Yema Maya Vishya Mano Yema Nityayukta Upasate Nityayukta Upasate Shraddhaya Parayopeta श्रद्धया परयोपेता तेमे युक्तममामताः तेमे युक्ततमामताः.
So Krishna gives a very clear answer without absolutely any ambiguity. He gives the answer. Whoever offers his mind completely to me, whose mind is immersed in me, and shraddhaya paryopetaha, supreme shraddha. Shraddha means sincerity, absolute sincerity plus faith. Or you can call it as sincerity of purpose. Whoever is devoted to me, completely offering his mind and worshipping Nitya Yukta Upasate every moment of his life, whoever is worshipping me, adoring me with supreme Shraddha, he is better. It is very clearly, he gives the answer.
Shramanirdeshyam Yetva Shramanirdeshyam Avyaktam Paryupasate
Avyaktam Paryupasate
Sarvatra Gamachintyamcha
Sarvatra Gamachintyamcha
Kutasthamachalam dhruvam
Kutasthamachalam dhruvam
Sanniyam mendriyagramam
Sanniyam mendriyagramam
Sarvatra samabuddhayah
Sarvatra samabuddhayah
Te prabhuvanti mameva
Te prabhuvanti mameva
Sarvabhuta hite rata
Sarvabhuta hite rata.
These two shlokas together, Sri Krishna tells Arjuna, it is not that others will not reach me. You ask the question, who is the better? One who is devoted to my form is better, very clear. But the second one also, who is devoted to the formless aspect of mine. In the third shloka, which is the first of the two which were chanted together, Krishna himself explains what is the formless, attributeless aspect. He is unmanifest, kutastham achalam dhruvam. He doesn't have a form, but he is kutastha. Kuta means who is inside everyone, inside the whole universe. He pervades the whole universe and who is beyond that also. After telling Arjuna, these are the ones who are devoted to the formless, attributeless ones of mine. They are also mine. But then he explains, Sanniyam Indriyagramam, one who is completely self-controlled, who has established control over his senses, Sarvatra Samabuddhayaha, and everywhere he has equanimity. He looks at everyone, every being, everything equally. He does not distinguish between one person and another person, between animal and insect and worm, because he is seeing me everywhere. See, that is the formless aspect means what? Previous shloka, he says, one who is devoted to my form. Here he says, formless aspect, but he is not only devoted to this formless aspect, he sees me in everyone, sarvatra samabuddhayaha, and then sarvabhuta hite rataha. What is he doing? All the time, He is serving me by thinking of welfare of all the beings in the universe. He is always helping, he is always serving. He will also reach me. This is what is said in these two shlokas put together. What it means, see, there are many people who take to the formless aspect of God. Many means not that, you know, they have chosen. Many people, there are particular religions which don't talk about the form of God. So they naturally, because they are born in that religion, they naturally take to that. They have to take to, whether they understand or not, they have to take to it. Therefore, Lord Krishna, he doesn't want to exclude them. They also belong to me. One who worships me in my form, is also, he also belongs to me. He will also reach me. At the same time, one who is devoted to the formless aspect of mine, attributeless aspect of mine, he will also reach me. Therefore, there is no disappointment for the second category of devotees. But very clearly he says, the first one is better. Why is explained in the next shlokas.
अव्यक्ता हि गतिर्दुःखम् देहवद्भिरवाप्यते.
So here he explains how it is so difficult for somebody with a form, one who has identified himself with the body and individuality, the body consciousness, how it is so difficult for him to conceive of God who is formless. Kleshaha adhikataraha tesham. For them, difficulty is more. So when he says one who is devoted to the form is better, what it means is, he is not really saying which is better. He is saying it is easier. It is better you start with the sakara. That's what very clearly he is saying. It is more difficult for people to visualize, because there is no form. How do you visualize him? How do you think of God who is formless? Hey, this is a small baby. You explain to him about electricity. What will he understand? You say, so here is a wire, there is, this is no electricity is passing, it is transmission, something. The child will not understand. How does he understand? You show a bulb. So you see this? Yes. And see, there electricity is there. The child will understand. Therefore, formless aspect, they are very difficult. Therefore, better you choose the form. Avyaktahi gatir dukkham dehavadbirivaravapyate. One who is having this body consciousness, it will lead to grief, he says. It is like many people who try to start meditation in the beginning. It will lead to grief only. Right? You sit down. So Swami has said, I want to do meditation. 10 minutes at least, let me sit. 10 minutes become the most difficult part of your 24 hours in the day. It is filled with so much of sorrow, grief. In the beginning, even to visualize a form is so very difficult. How will you visualize something which is formless? Therefore, he is saying, between the two, this is easier, this is very difficult.
This is enough. This is the beginning of the Bhagavad Gita's 12th chapter. This is the introduction to the 12th chapter. But between the form and the formless, how do I go about? That is Arjuna's question. Because Arjuna represents everybody. All the confusion in the mind of man is represented in Arjuna in Bhagavad Gita. So as he said, between the form and formless, those who worship the formless aspect, and between the form, who do you think is better? But Krishna does not say better. He comes back and says, both will attain me. You come this way or you come that way, both will attain me. But those who try to attain me without a form, thinking of me as the anirdeshyam, aksharam, For them, the difficulty is more. It's a little difficult way of achieving me. The other way is little easier because you have a body. So it's easy for you to relate to another body. For a small elephant, a big elephant is God. For a small fish, big fish is God. How will fish imagine God? It'll imagine a bigger fish, very, very powerful. How will the small creature imagine a large creature as God? So for man, who are human, who has a body, he'll be able to imagine God also in a similar way. We all want to see our reflection in everything. So God also, we want to see our reflection. Then we will see the reflection of God in us, once we have become close to. That Upanishad story is there. One bird and the other bird, both are on the same tree. A bird will appreciate only the other bird. Could that story be in a bird and another snake on top? Could that have been, or that Upanishadic story of a small Mari, Simba the Mari, small cub, relates to a bigger lion? He could not relate to, if there was an elephant instead of lion in the Upanishadic story, could this little cub relate to that elephant as God? No, he saw his reflection in the bigger one. So we want to see God as us. As of course, we give them more attributes. Chaturbhuja will make them 4 hands, 6 hands, 8 hands. But that is our way of telling God, you are 10 more times more powerful than us. You are 12 times more powerful than us. That's why we worship you. And that is the idea of relating to God. Now, this, because he started one idea, he said there are religions where there is no concept of a form. In fact, that has led to bhakti movement started because of that conflict only. When there are people who started destroying temples, throwing murtis, destroying scriptures, wherever the form was mentioned. And so the bhakti movement people, even more to reunite people together, they all the more worship the forms, saying that no, form is important, form is real. So that was when happening. You think like this. Once somebody was arguing with me, there is formless God and things like that. I told them, why do you say Allah Acha Karega? Why you don't say Allah Acha Karegi? Isn't it? Why it has to be a male? Why it should not be a female? Why God in the heaven has to be with a beard? Why it cannot be with long hair like women? Because somewhere that society then started thinking of God in the way it is suitable to them. But still everybody thought of God as somebody, some being. Even ours say, I should not leave Hinduism out. They also called him Purusha, Purusha Suktam. Why didn't they call it Stri? At least we have one Shakti Upasakas. They will call her the Parameshwari from where everything is. Lalita Sahasranam says that. At least we have a little more argument, but other places no argument. They straight away called the God as male. But even in those who thought God is inexpressible, unmanifest, they also ultimately thought of God in a particular being form only. They could not think, otherwise it's unimaginable. How can you think emptiness? Inside the room, there is emptiness you can think. Without the room, how do you think emptiness is my question. So without the form, how do you think of formless? It's not possible. One may think it is possible, that is one's own imagination. But as I said, that is also with continuous dhyana yoga. You continuously do meditation on the thought, I'm Brahmasmi, you will realize that also. But it does not negate the idea of having a form as the first step to worship. That is the easiest. And that is why God keep coming back in different forms. In order for us to develop a kinship, so that we understand what God is like, what is God's love, what it is to love God and what it is to be loved by God. At least we taste that divine love, so we get attached to a particular form, and then we start going closer and closer. We want to become closer and closer. And we attain God that way. From Shravanam, we listen to, oh, so there is a Baba by name Sai Baba of Puttaparthi. Somebody heard it. Somebody read it in a book. And then slowly, they attended the local bhajan. They heard the bhajans. They felt it is nice. Then slowly, they thought, okay, let me think of him. If he can really help me, let me pray and see. I have a trouble. They prayed. Maybe their trouble was resolved. Then they said, I must do something for Sai Baba. He has done something for me. Physically, he has not done anything. But because of their prayers answered, then Pada Sevanam, they become a Sevadal or a volunteer or something. And then keep doing once in a while Seva to permanent Sevadal they become. I want to serve God please take me in an institution, give me a little place, let me serve you. So the sevanam becomes dasyam. And then what happens? Slowly you become kinship with Swami. Swami suddenly becomes your father, mother, friend, guru, everything. All of a sudden, some Baba who was in a photo suddenly becomes the most important person in your life. It's in a matter of time. And ultimately what happens? What do you pray to Swami then for? Please Swami, make me merge in you. Make me realize you. Make me become one with you. That is Atmanivedanam. If Swami was not there in the first place as a form, do you think all this process was possible? Do you think anybody walking on the road somewhere could have just thought, I must become God? It wouldn't have been possible. That is why an avatar manifests, gives his love, answers the prayers, attracts the people towards himself or herself, whichever way it is. And then slowly, 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 the kinship grows till you develop, all other desires disappear. We start with artis, but ultimately we become jnanis. We shun all the desires. We say, I just want you, Swami. I just want to realize you. I know you are Parabrahma Swarupa. I don't understand that, but I know you are that. Please help me realize that. So we slowly grow to that formless aspect only. But we start with the form. So in your own case, you apply this. If there was no form, was it possible for you to suddenly relate to so many good things of spirituality? It wouldn't have been possible. So today, in present context, there is Swami. In past context, there was Rama or Krishna. Or even after there, not being there, other devotees, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he sang glory of Puri Jagannath or Krishna. Or Ramakrishna sang to Mother Kali. But they all could connect with the form because we have a form. It is impossible for us to relate to something which is not like us. It has to be something like us for us to relate to it. That is why Deha Vadbhiravapita. Because we have a body, we have to think of God as somebody who also has a body, but with superpowers to begin with. And ultimately realize the purity, Satchidananda. That is at the last stage. But the beginning, he has superpowers. He can cure our illnesses. He can solve our problems. He can give what we want. With that, we develop this kinship and ultimately reach there that we don't want anything from God. Anapeksha we become. Desireless. And we say, we just want you for your sake. But without a form, so many of these things to relate is not possible. That is why Krishna says, easier path is this. You can take a Jnanamarga also. Run away from the society, sit in a cave and give up everything and completely all the time think of Aham Brahmasmi, Aham Brahmasmi. Imagine if I take to the Jnanamarga path here and all of you have to give up everything and go to a cave and sit there and just depend on God for your sustenance and then sit down and meditate whole day, whole night that you are divine. Two Shrutis to correct and come next day is difficult for you. Thinking of Parabrahman as the formless in a cave, do you think it is going to be possible? So this is the easier path is what Krishna concludes. I am not saying these people are greater, those people are lesser. Because Arjuna is very clever. He says, which of the two are better, Yoga Vittama? Arjuna's question, you see, how immature. Means I should tell you truth as it is. Arjuna's question is immature. K Yoga Vittama, which of the students of two students is better? Which is the better singer? Which is the better speaker? Like we compare as students of... And Krishna's answer is so mature. He comes back, he doesn't say, you know what, these are better and this is lesser. He simply says, those who worship me, Maya Veshita, all their mind is in me, Niveshyasi, completely absorbed in me, they are also my devotees. They also reach me. Also those who are devoted to me in this way by worshipping my Nirakara form, they also reach me. Both will reach me. But between the two, the good advice is to begin with, form is the easier path. Think of Krishna, Rama or any Hanuman, Devi, Sai Baba or any name, any form. And you will be able to associate yourself better. So that is the idea. And why I am explaining to this at the beginning is that bhakti means there has to be a form. Without form, you cannot do bhakti. Without form, only jnana comes. Very difficult to do bhakti. So once Swami Vivekananda, he was propagating this Hinduism that time, when a lot of people were taking to other religions, even British were calling all this as superstition and things like that. So he went into a king's court. The king said, I don't believe in all this form worship, this murti pujas and these things. How can God be seen in that? Who's supposed to be infinite, how can he become finite in a particular lingam or a particular murti? In fact, if you go back 1,000 years, the same argument was between Mandana Mishra and Shankaracharya. Vedanta and, that is, Karmakanda and Jnanakanda was their argument. Shankaracharya was saying, God is unmanifest, he is in everything, in everyone. There is no doubt about it. Whereas, and that is the way to know God. Vedanta is the way to know God. Whereas Mandana Mishra's way was Mimamsa, Upurva Mimamsa. He said, no, you have to go through rituals, you have to pray, you have to do this, you have to attain God through these rituals. But Vedanta, he said no. So that was the argument, formless and form aspect. Because when you perform ritual, whom do you offer? You have to offer to some form, he was saying, Vedanta. Now Vivekananda coming to that, he said, well, whose picture is that on the wall? And then this king said, that is my father, forefather, everybody's pictures will be there in the king's court. Then his Vivekananda told, get me that picture, one of the pictures. He brought, so, and Vivekananda said, the minister was there, he told minister, you spit it on the picture, the painting. And the minister was confused. He said, how can I spit it? It is king's picture, king's painting. He said, but king is not in the picture, isn't it? King is here. That is only a picture, a painting. Why don't you spit it on it, spit on that? He said. The minister got worried. Then Vivekananda explained, see, just as though the picture is not you, but still we believe you are in the picture, you are in the painting. Likewise, though God is not just the form, but we believe form is also God. For us to relate to God, that unmanifest infinite, this particular representation in a form is our way of associating with it. Therefore, you cannot say that this is true and that is not true. That's why Krishna also did not say that this is the way and that is not the way. He said both are the ways, but this is the easier way. But as you keep doing this bhakti, what does Narada say in the beginning? Atma Ramo Bhavati, Amruto Bhavati. You will become that. You will become one with the divine. And then all these forms and names will disappear. So what Ramakrishna would give example is, there are two thorns. One thorn is got inside your flesh. Now how do you remove this thorn? With another thorn, isn't it? Likewise, to understand Nirakara, you need Sakara first. And with Sakara, you can understand Nirakara and then discard both, because you can become one with that. There is nothing more. But to understand that you are divine and everything is Sarvam Kalvidam Brahman, Sarva Bhuteshu Chatmani, all these ideas are only theory otherwise. And you can take great pride that I know too much of Vedanta, I know all the Upanishads, I can quote from anywhere. But the truth is that your wisdom is nothing. You don't know about it. You just know it by rote. So bhakti helps you to ultimately reach there, to realize that you and your divine are one. And divine is not just the form, he is Parabrahma, is infinite, is everyone. So even though in Karnataka, if you see Ramanujacharya's, the Madhvacharya's were there, even they say that forms are the important, ultimately you will find here and there they hint about calling God as everything. But to promote a path, they kept on saying that this is the way. But ultimately all of them agree that God is, one side you say God is everything and everyone. Other side you say God is only Vishnu. How is it possible? You are only chanting Vishwam Vishnumayam. And then you say that, no, that is not Vishnu, this is alone Vishnu. This Vigraha is Vishnu, the rest is not Vishnu. How can that be double standard? But to understand, similarly you say Allah is everywhere, they say. Then you believe that even in Hindu there is Allah only, no? Even in that wood, piece of wood is Allah. Even in the Vigraha, it is also Allah. So that is where Sanatana Dharma comes. Hinduism is far more broad in its approach. It said, as you require, so to that extent you can worship. If you want to create a new God tomorrow, I don't like any of these gods market, he said, no, you have plenty of choices. I don't want any of these choices. I want one more to create for myself. Very well, go ahead. As long as you have Shraddha Bhakti, that you will experience. Your experience is a measure of your own Shraddha, it says. So that's why Krishna says, Yo Yo Yam Yam Tanum Bhakta. Whichever form, whichever Bhakta wants to worship, Shraddha Dham. I want to, with Shraddha, I want to worship. Architum Ichasi, I want to worship that, I feel. Tasya Tasya, to them in that form, Achalam Shraddha, unshakable Shraddha, I give. Tamayeva Vidadam Miham, I will give in that particular form. If you think Shirdi Baba is the God and you are completely Ananya Bhakta, continuously always thinking of Him, you will realize yourself through that path. If you think Satya Sai Baba is the only way, you will realize through that path also. Because somewhere down the line, you realize that all rivers go and merge in the same ocean. A real Bhakta will see His divine in everything, everywhere, and He will not debate between form and formless. He will say, yes, ultimately I have to realize the formless only, but I have to go through the form. And because, not because this is better or that is lesser, it is only because this is easier. So I am taking the easier path, not the higher one. So let us understand that that is the introduction to the Bhakti Yoga, that why Bhakti is important. Somebody has to understand, isn't it? A jnani comes and debates with you. No, no, Jnana Marga is better than your Bhakti Marga. What is these idols and what is this pouring water and doing Abhisheka and tying clothes to a stone? They will argue. That time you say, I'm not arguing you are lesser or better. This is my path. I find it easier. I know your path is also true. And you will also attain the same thing. But this is my path. So you don't have to become diffident. Nor you have to become, you don't have to attack him also. That what you're saying is wrong. You say, I agree. Formless only is God. Nishkalo, Niranjano, Nirakara. All that agree. But for me, to begin with, I find it easier. I love it to treat God as my mother, to treat God as my father, as my friend, and develop that kind of bhakti. And that helps me. So it is for my own help, for my own sake that I am doing this, not to prove anybody anything. So Bhakti Yoga allows you to develop this broad-mindedness. And right in the beginning, Krishna clears the confusion. Please don't get into any debate with any jnani who will claim otherwise. Lot of jnanis, self-proclaimed jnanis claim like that. They have no jnana. If they had jnana, there won't be any argument at all. They'll understand form, formless, everything is same. Because they are truly not jnanis. That is why they say like that. That is why scriptures, our scriptures have comment on everybody, including these kind of foolish people who think they know everything. It says, Kato Upanishad lo kuda rasundi. What does he do? He is actually installed himself in Agyana. And what he says? Pandita Swayam Manyamana. He thinks that I am only Pandita. Though he is into complete Agyana. Avidya Mantare Vidyamana. In the Avidya he is soaked inside. Antare, inside Avidya he is surrounded by it. But he thinks Swayam Pandita Manyamana. I am Pandita in those things. And how is that person? How the Upanishad laughs at that person? He says, Pariyante Dandramvyamana Pariyante Mudaha. He says, like the foolish person who takes to crooked ways. How? Andhaiva, like Andha means blind person. Andhaineva Niyamana Yathandhaha. The way a blind person leads the blind person, like that these people are, who think they know too much, but they actually know nothing. And they keep going in circles because they're blind. They're not knowing where they're going. So Pariyanti, keep going round and round, keep quoting from scriptures, fight, argue, debate, thinking they're jnani. If they're truly jnani, Advaita Darshanam, then they should know that everything is one. Even if you worship God as a small stone, God is God. Whichever akara, lingakara, sakara, nirakara, everything is God. So where is the question from a jnani? Where is the argument from a jnani? Who is a jnani? Who thinks he's a jnani? Pandita, manyamana, he has decided, I am Pandita. But how is he? He's a blind man who's leading other people also on the same blind track, going round and round in circles. So the idea of Bhakti Yoga is so mature. The way Krishna presented that idea, that doesn't matter whichever path you take, but this is easier path. Now what is this path? How to walk on this path? What are the qualities of people who walk this path? How they can become dear to God? How they can become near to God? That is all coming in the next shlokas. Another 2-3 shlokas will talk about the same thing. Choose one of these paths, whichever is easier for you. And then it will get into the pure bhakti part, where it will start describing about the qualities of a devotee. So that is where I want to focus. These are all introductions to that bhakti yoga. But the real bhakti yoga begins after 4 more shlokas, where it starts telling what kind of person is a true bhakta and how he should lead or she should lead one's life on this earth and how they can attain. Already we have got the guarantee from Narada. Just in case you develop this bhakti, you have got everything. You have got your tripto bhavati, siddho bhavati, amruto bhavati, atma ramo bhavati, matto bhavati, everything bhavati. You will get everything. So this is like one thing you get everything. And therefore getting bhakti is so important. But bhakti is not when you say, I am a bhakta. You cannot claim. Again, you will be otherwise that paryante mudha. You will be telling, I am bhakta, I am a devotee. That is not the devotee. Devotee should come from me. So who is priya to Krishna? Who is dear to the Lord? All those qualities come in the coming shlokas. So I want you to go back. Of course, you read this for academic sake, these first few shlokas. But for your life's requirement, we will do that other part of the Bhakti Yoga shlokas. And each quality, we must think, and after going back, you must ask, how can I improve in this quality? I know for today itself, I cannot become that. But how can I day after day after day start improving on these qualities? And how can I get closer and closer? Keeps on repeating Krishna. Yo mad bhakta same priya. This kind of devotee is devoted to me. This kind of devotee is dear to me. He keeps repeating. So if you want to be near to Swami, you have to be dear to Swami. And Bhakti Yoga will tell you how to be dear to Swami. So that is the idea of Bhakti Yoga. So this is one of my most favorite chapters because it talks about my favorite people. All other chapters of Bhagavad Gita, they are more intellectual. They glorify God. They tell you about dharma, they tell you about karma, they tell you about all kinds of things. But the sweetest chapter, if all Bhagavad Gita is considered as a meal, the sweetest chapter is Bhakti Yoga. And that is why I am so, so particular that all of you at least learn, and if not remember, at least remember a few things of this Bhakti Yoga, even one shloka, two shloka. Adveshta sarva bhutana, maitra karuneva cha, anapeksha shuchir daksha. Even one shloka, you put it in your life and practice it. He says, Bhavami Nachirat Partha. From this Sambhutyu Samsara Sagarat, Bhavami Nachirat Partha. Without delay, I will take you across this Mutyu Sagara. If only you become dear to me, I become your in charge. Sarvadharman Parityajya. Forget everything else, just do this for me, Krishna says. I will take care of everything. Moksha Ishyami. I'll give you moksha also. So that is all we are asking, especially now that you are dealing with some form and you have to move out from this form to the formless someday. This is the good beginning, but this is not the end. This is just the beginning. The easier path is the beginning, but the end is same to both the paths. Let us not forget that goal too.
Kanada Raja Pandaritsa, Kanada Raja Pandaritsa, Kanada Raja Pandaritsa, Kanada Raja Pandaritsa. Sa prakat lai
Down.